to continue to do some kind of work on that, because some continue to work. As I said, I work at the paper mill, but I'm preaching at Manning, so I'm kind of semi-retired. So in talking about challenges to retiring, I'm not fully retired, and if the Lord spares me as long as I can go, I'm going to continue to be semi-retired. Whether I'm preaching at Manning or not, there's always going to be some kind of activity that I want to do, something to keep me going. You need a purpose. You need to plan to do something. So you don't have to continue to work, but you need some kind of activity. But as we transition, and I'm going to try to hurry him because I didn't expect this to be that long. But as we transition, we've got to think about when we leave work. There are a lot of challenges, especially in the first year of retirement. Because now you've made a change, and making that change and dealing with that change can be a challenge to some people. So there are some common and acceptable things, the feelings and emotions, thinking that people go through. Sometimes it's positive. There's a feeling of relief, of relief and accomplishment. But then there are also some unpopular feelings that people go through because of the inactivity, because you don't hold that position or that importance that you used to have, that can be a problem for some folk. Some retirees experience separation anxiety. Some experience a loss of friendships, mainly because of their relationships that they had at work. A lot of friends they made, a lot of the things that they used to do made them feel important. If I was a supervisor at work, or if I was the main person in my department, a lot of people looked to me and interacted with a lot of people, both my peers as well as management. And there were people that kind of esteemed you and looked up to you because of that position. When you retire, you go home. You don't have that position anymore. And those folks who used to call you Mr. Halbert, my wife said, hey, go, will you go to that shift, please? But she expected you to go do this or that. Whereas I used to tell folks, it's like that centurion, he told Jesus, I'm not worthy. Because I too have people under me. I say, go here and do this, or go there and do that, and people go. But when you're at home, you don't have that luxury anymore and that kind of recognition. And so things will change in that regard. And a lot of people that you used to be friends with, you forged relationships over decades, a lot of those people aren't there anymore. And I've heard a lot of retirees say, I miss the people. I miss the friends at work. And so that relationship is not going to be there. For some, it can feel like a divorce. It can feel like losing a loved one. For some, it has been said, it is almost like quitting an addictive substance, cold turkey. This separation anxiety can also be likened to the grieving process we experience when losing a loved one. Now you've got to think about it, that for the average person, you have been doing this activity for about 40 years. That's a long time out of somebody's life. And when you consider at least 8 hours a day, 40 years. Now that is a third of a person's life. So when you stop doing that, there can be some anxiety. And you're going to have to get used to that as you make that transition. Some people tend to feel unproductive or useless because this activity, this function that I used to perform at work, I'm not doing that anymore. And now I'm around the house, and sometimes we don't have a whole lot to do. There were expectations placed on us from an early age. You had to get good grades, you had to go to school. There were chores around the house. There were things that I had to do. And if I didn't do it, I was motivated to do it. And I can remember, I told fellas, my dad used to have us doing things, chopping wood, and cleaning the yard. That was before lawns got popular. But you had to keep the yard clean. And if there was any grass growing, we had to either sling or hoe that grass. Back during the time when I was growing up, when the roads weren't paved, we had ditch banks. You had to keep the ditch black bank clean. Young people today don't know nothing about a sling and a hoe. But we had to keep those things clean, or we were encouraged that. So there were chores. And I used to always get angry because some of those other boys would be running up and down the street, and I had to stay home, me and my brother. Mostly me, because my brother could sneak off and get away with it. Anytime I sneak off, I got caught. I got punished. But we were working, and they were roaming up and down the street. Which wasn't a bad thing, because later on when I got a job and continued to work, was committed to working and bringing in some money so that I could live and eventually take care of my family. Some of those boys were still walking up and down the street. They had learned to work. And so there are expectations, and certainly through our jobs and careers, those expectations in our occupations continue. But now once you retire, you have to get used to not having the expectations and demands on your workday. You can literally sit around and do nothing. You have to get into the habit of making your days functional. Find something to occupy your time. And I guess for most of us who are married, if you got a wife, there's such a thing called a honey do list. And there are a whole lot of things that honey wants you to do. Honey, will you do this? Or honey, will you do that? And some of us comply with honey. Some don't. There are some people that don't. We have to avoid the trap of becoming lazy. We have to avoid the trap. You know, I done worked all these years. I'm retired now. Well, you know, we can just sit around and lay around doing nothing. You can stay in bed too long. You know, and the proverb writer has something about that. A man turning in his bed is like a door turning on his hinges. We can stay in bed too long, but you don't want to fall into that trap. Not doing tasks around the house, around the home, and if you don't, things will start falling apart on you. Just don't become sedentary. Just sit around doing nothing. I've known people who've retired and say, I ain't gonna do nothing.
That's right.
What will happen if you just don't drive a car? You got a car, you let it sit up for months and months and months, and you don't drive. What will happen to that car? Or what will happen to a house if people move out of that house and the doors and windows are not open and closed and it's heated and cool? What would happen to that house? It eventually deteriorates. And the same thing can happen to a person that retires. That's why we've got to plan something for our day. You need to find something to help you to stay active and healthy. And we also got to maintain good relationships, good marital relations. Because now, where I used to be away from my wife for most of my day, now I'm around my wife most of the day. And the thing we don't want to do is we don't want to bring the stresses and arguments from our daily routine into our marriage. In essence, you don't want to get on one another's nerves. Because sometimes we can do that. This woman getting on, she always wanted me to do something. Well, You know, and I think Brother Ram dealt with that. And now that I'm here, I am dealing with my wife because of just she and me in the house. And ain't no chilling there. And so you know how things can get. And now I'm getting on her nerve. Well, Brother Ram said it beautifully, and I agree. We got to learn to tolerate one another. We got to learn to put up with one another.
That's right.
And we got to communicate with one another. We have got to continue to build that good relationship. And that relationship should have been built all of those years. But retirement can bring some stresses to the matter. The one thing we don't want to do is to get on one another's nerves. And then let me just touch on some good things about retirement, because we now have newfound freedom and time on our hand to do some of the things that you always wanted to do. You have time now to watch your favorite TV shows, or you can binge watch some, but again, don't sit and watch TV too long, because they talk about a couch potato. Potatoes sitting for too long grow sprouts and eventually begins to rot. So you got time, but don't spend too much time watching TVs and going to the movies. You also have time to travel or vacation as you so choose. I don't have to go to work anymore. I can go and visit this place, or I can go and visit that place, or I can go fishing, or I can, if I like racing go-karts, or whatever it is I like to do, you have time to travel or vacation to do as you choose. You can do volunteer work, you can devote more time to church work, and especially those of us that are spiritually minded, when you retire, you got more time to give to God. So we've got a lot more time, more freedom. You can spend more time with the grandchildren. And some of us love our grandchildren. Some of us don't want to be around those grandchildren. But now, I think as parents, we can also contribute to how those grandchildren are coming up and being raised. And if they're spoiled, we can give them some a dose of reality. Help them to deal with the real issues of life, because everybody out there don't love you like your mom might. And so we got to get our children to understand that, and our grandchildren. Or you have the time to just do whatever in this world you feel like doing. But we've got time on our hands. So there are some good things about retirement, and there are a lot of other good things we can do, because again, some of us, when we retire, it's like just reinstating our marriages. I know some folks are talking about renewing their vows. Well, that's a time of renewal. Because now you got a husband and wife, and they don't have any children. They don't have to go to work. We can go on a perpetual date. Man, that's a wonderful time. So there are some good things to retirement. There's some challenges, but there's also some benefits to retirement. And I've used most of my time, but I've got about 5 minutes left. Anybody got any questions or concerns or about retirement? Yes?
I've got a statement that you alluded to it, but especially for young people, do not set your heart on Social Security, even if you're going to drop on it, because that will not support you.
That's right. And they're talking about it running out in 20 to 30 years. So there might not be a Social Security. One of the best things that young people can do is invest in a Roth 401k. Or something, and the Roth 401k is best, because you pay your taxes on it while you're putting the money in, and when you draw your money out, you don't have to pay taxes on it. They also suggest that you put a portion of your savings into an annuity, An annuity is something that will pay you a guaranteed amount each and every month so that you can have some guaranteed income. And this is generally after age 65 because these annuities are intended to pay for about 20 years. A lot of folk live to, age 85, but if the Lord bless you, you know, you got 3 score and 10 or 4 score or 4 score and 10. You want to be able to live comfortably. You don't want to be in the poorhouse.
I think also, if it's possible, pay off your mortgage before you retire so that even if you get less income, you're not sending out as much as far as mortgage.
Yeah, and that is a good thing. And even people with mortgages, again, they've got all kinds of things out there. A lot of folks get into what you see advertised on TV, these reverse mortgages. That may not be the best thing for the family, especially if you hope to leave your house to your children. So you've got to look into all of these financial instruments and these arrangements that they're offering. It sound good, but like old folks say, everything that sound good. Amen.
Brother Tucker, I'd like maybe to encourage all of us, don't bring home a whole lot, especially our preachers. Mm-hmm. But I try to encourage people, if it's $5 per week, mm-hmm. you put aside. I just mm-hmm. use $5 mm-hmm. for your salary or whatever, put that aside for a rainy day. Mm-hmm. It might come up in 12 months, 52 weeks by 5, mm-hmm. At least you have that amount of money. If you fall on a rainy day, you have that as a backup. Because a lot of times, people don't have any backup.
That's right.
When the things happen.
That's right. That's right. And sometimes, as he said, we've got to make provisions for those contingencies. Sometimes the car breaks down. We driving those cars all the time. You're gonna need tires. You need to keep your oil changed. And whenever you have contingencies, the refrigerator goes out or whatever. You've got to have money for that. One thing that folks are encouraged to do is to save at least 10%. That's a good basis to start with. At least 10% of your income. If you can put that aside and don't touch it. If you need the contingency fund, try to put aside another 5% or whatever for the contingency fund. But have some money that you can fall back on if and when you need to. But certainly, put aside some money to save. And a lot of young people nowadays don't save, but you need to try to budget, set up your finances so that you can put aside some money. And especially us preachers who don't get a whole lot of money, put aside some money. And when we file our taxes, a lot of us get a little bit of money back. Don't take every dollar and run to Walmart. That's when you can put $1,000, $2,000, whatever, into a Roth IRA. That adds up over time. So use that money wisely. And when the Lord blesses you with a little extra, put a little extra aside, for a rainy day.
Maybe I'll have to come to you guys to see how we could get back the taxes.
Well, Donald already took care of
it. Let me say something about the preachers. When it comes to housing allowances, the government allows you to reduce your income by the housing allowance. Mm-hmm. That's your rent or your mortgage, your utilities and so forth. Whatever you buy for that house, you have to do it in advance. Mm-hmm. If you're going to spend $20,000 a year in your house upkeep, then that deducts from your income, mm-hmm. so you don't have to pay as much taxes on it.
Right.
You can almost zero out if you keep your mileage and all that stuff up.
Right.
We got to be wise in how we use what we get.
Amen.
So that we can take full benefit of it. And so those are there to make it whereby the evangelist doesn't pay all of that tax.
That's right.
And so it helps out.
and you have got to keep very, very good records. I can tell you because I've been audited. And if you don't have records, buddy, they're going to write you a new tax bill. But if you've got records, then everything's good. So as he said, your mileage, the meals and everything, even the clothes that you buy, because they talk about clergy uniform, but we don't wear uniform. We don't wear robes and whatnot. But our folk expect us to be dressed decently. And whether you wear suits or not, you know, clothes that you buy, that's deductible. But you got to keep good records. Because whenever Iris calls, you better be able to answer adequately, or they're going to take some of your money.
All right, we appreciate it.